Hello, everyone. Welcome to the John Sitton Football and Centre podcast with me, Joe Mealing, asking the questions. So, John of Sitton, how are you, my liege?
Yeah, I'm good, mate. Yeah, you?
Yeah, I'm good, mate. Yeah, I'm sound. Yeah, not bad at all. Not bad. Yeah. We've had the England friendly against Romania, second string side. First game is on Sunday against Croatia.
Yeah.
Be good to get your thoughts in the last game before the first game of the tournament, and take me through, if you can, Southgate's thoughts on playing a second string side, obviously playing players that weren't in the squad. What's your thoughts on it? What was your analysis of the game? What did he learn from it, I guess?
Well, he'd done it in both of them, didn't he? He'd done it in the Austria game as well, where if the truth be told, I thought we were lucky to get the result. Mm. Particularly having spoke about the easy way that the England back four, whatever he plays, I just thought that the centre-backs were too easily dissected. At one where the Geezers made the third man run and headed it down and wide.
Yeah.
There was a couple of others, ricochets, possible shout for a penalty. So, yeah, I mean, in answer to your question, I could see both sides of the argument, because people have been throwing it up on Twitter. What would you do? Would you give the players a run out and use it as a rehearsal for your starting 11? Or do what I think Southgate did, use it as a chance to maybe have a late look at one or two, a little bit of experimentation with formations, which we can come to. And I'm still not convinced about it. And they said on, I think Pugac was saying about, they put a starting 11 with certain names and others, yeah, like blacked out or white stickered out with a question mark.
And
will he know he's starting 11? And I actually sent a thing in and say, well, he might start know he's starting 11, but does he know his best 11? Because that's always open to conjecture, and it's one of them where you're an idiot and nothing. But I just think he possibly used it to rest a few and just have sort of like a last little look at one or two doubts. We got away with it.
Yeah, we did get away. Obviously, the other thing to note is Trent Alexander-Arnold obviously got a thigh injury, so he's out of the Euros. And I guess that game was sort of the last chance for players to, certainly the James Ward-Prowse and Ben Godfrey and Iman White, to stake a claim for that position. And he's gone for young White, isn't he? Would you agree with that decision? The decision to bring in Ben White as opposed to, say, someone like Godfrey or Ward-Prowse, who, I mean, you probably know from some of my tweets, I think James Ward-Prowse it could be a real big addition to the squad, even before Trent left, and particularly now with Trent not in the squad, who's a great dead ball and set piece specialist. James Ward-Prowse had a great game, plus he's a very good dead ball and set piece specialist, but he's chosen not to choose him. But so yeah, just thoughts on that.
Well, I agree with you. I think it's going to be paramount, because if you're... Let's start at the end and work our way back to the beginning in terms of the names you've thrown up. I did call them Godfrey and White a while back.
Yeah, so, I remember that, yeah.
It's one of them I've got to reach behind and give myself a pat on the back. And fast forward to the last bit that you said, I think it's imperative because of the type of players we got. I think when you look at the likes of Sterling, when you look at the likes of Mount, Foden, Grealish, I think they're going to induce, they're going to invite tackles, and they're going to induce fouls, and it's going to be imperative that we're really top notch. And I mean top notch, I mean well rehearsed and top notch with the movement and the delivery on all set pieces.
Yeah,
it's a shame, like you say, that he's not in there, because he's one of the greatest exponents of it. With regards to the shout out of the other two, I think it's a good shout, Ben White, because I was making a case for him, or making a case for Godfrey possibly for the future. Alexander-Arnold's had a bit of an up and down season. He came good,
yeah,
but he's one of them. I could see the revenge. I could see the motives behind it, but all the when he called one in, you know, big block capital letters, are you not entertained? You know, all this sort of thing. Just you've got to have the ability just when you're at that level, just to stay focused and dare I say it in layman's terms, just fuck it off, completely ignore any peripheral bullshit and stay absolutely 100% focused on your own rest, recovery, recuperation, training and playing, which is how I try to educate players and got ridiculed for it 27 years ago. Yeah, a bit unfortunate. I was gutted because he would have slotted perfectly into the team that I would like to have seen start and the formation I would like to have seen start. What he's done, he's probably released. He's probably said, well, I know he announced four right backs with him dropping out. Alexander Arnold dropping out. I think like now he's made a case for himself in the starting 11, Ben White on the right hand side, or maybe even in the middle of a three.
It's funny actually. Yeah.
Releases the other right backs.
Yeah, because you mentioned the Mark Pugac sort of like starters. You know, the ITV kind of, you know, made a call to say what they think, who they believe are starters, and then there's obviously question marks as to who's going to fill in the gaps. But one of those starters, which I was surprised, that'd be interesting to know your thoughts, given Alexander Arnold can't play, was your man at Chelsea, Reece James, sorry. They put him down as a starter in front of Trippier. Would you agree with that? Do you think that Reece James has now got that right wing back / right back position?
It depends what Harry's going to think. I mean, to me, a lot of it is very contradictory. I think Reece James probably get the nod ever so slightly, and I mean ever so slightly over Trippier. I mean, I know he got the thing with a free kick, the opening goal in the semi-final against Croatia way back when.
Yeah.
I think they're both excellent going forward, but I just think he very narrowly gets the nod in terms of the quality of his delivery. But then for me, going the other way, Trippier, they've both had success, European Champions League, Chelsea, Reece James, FA Cup, the FA Cup final, Leicester, top four finish. The other geezers won a pot. And now, which takes some doing, Atletico Madrid.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
But I'll just go the other way. I think Trippier gets a nod ever so slightly defensively, because I've always put big question marks over Reece James defensively. Well, our biggest problem, right? One of our biggest problems is the defender's furthest from the ball when the ball's on the opposite side. So if the ball's on the opposite side, coming down our left, the opposition's right, and a delivery is coming into the box, as we saw against Austria and Romania. And not forgetting Romania didn't have a full-strength side out. It's the furthest defender's ability to defend in the box. I'm still not convinced by how well we defend in the box. And probably the best exponents of it and people who've had a good year would be Stones and Maguire, who's injured.
Yeah.
But what concerns me are the opposite fullbacks. I don't think we're very good at defending when the ball's on the opposite side. And it's crying out for... But the reason I raised the point, Joe, is because if he's going to play two screening midfield players, which I suspect he will, which I don't agree with, maybe later on in the competition, right? And then maybe release the shackles later in the game. But most certainly, I think he's going to be overly cautious at the start of the competition and play two screening midfield players. Then it's basically cancelled out because the opposition will endeavour to get the ball wide and get deliveries into our penalty area where we're not very good.
So they nullify that, yeah. So they just bypass the two holding midfielders. Don't go through the middle, no point. Go down the wings.
The opposition, because it's deflecting the ball wide. The opposition the goal, right? And they'll move the ball quickly, side to side. And you feel they're not doing any damage. But then like you saw quite clearly against Austria, one diagonal ball or one ball infield. So what you do sometimes is you play narrow to pull everybody in, then you go wide. And that's what Austria did well against us. And I'll tell you, very good at that, the Germans. They go wide, they bring it in, and then they'll go into the front, back, wide, into the front, back, not wide, wide, but just to the midfield player next to him. Mm. And then it pulls everything in narrow. The opposition go, boom, we've got to be compact. So you're compact that way and you're compact that way. Mm. Soon as they recognise that the opposition have gone compact and played narrow, they go bang and get it wide. And then that's when I think we're struggling, because like Austria showed, with a couple of deliveries into the box, the marking in the box is not up to snuff. And it, and actually one delivery could have caused would have been a catastrophic injury to the goalkeeper. I'll see, as soon as he went over, and I'll see the way he done his thing, with the way he landed, everything jolted when he come out. He come out the piss. It was either palmed it away off. I think he punched it. I think he fisted it away. And then as he come over the top of the defender. We retreated too deep. And then you look at the placement of the bodies, and the marking's not up to snuff.
It's a funny one, isn't it? Because like you've just said there, you've got, you know, the sort of prevailing fashion in sort of modern day football is those two sort of inside forwards and then one sort of number nine up front. So it's all about spreading the play and getting it as wide as possible. And you have certainly, I mean, Pirlo was a great example of it. For Italy, I think he destroyed us in 2014 by just dropping deep, spraying balls around, making the game tick. Tony Kroos does it, or Kroos does it at Germany. And it's funny how the two holding midfielders, I mean, is that an antiquated sort of tactic now, given that how many teams actually go through the middle with a number 10, you know, in that little pocket? When it seems to be the whole sort of fashion, as I say, is to have it real lightning quick forwards, a real deep holding creative player to ping them balls out wide anyway. So is it fit for purpose, even having two holding midfielders?
Oh, it can possibly, it can backfire on you.
Yeah.
Because it can dictate to the opposition how they play. And they might be comfortable with that. There's two key ingredients, Joe, when you're setting up tactically or when you're coaching.
Yeah.
Two key ingredients of many, many key ingredients. But the formation we pick is going to be vital. While I think of it off the top of my head, there's three, right? So then you're looking at the placement of players, yeah, which ties in what you're saying about the... I mean, he started it, didn't he? His first time round at Chelsea. They called it the Makélélé role. He invented it, didn't he? Jose Makélélé, with regards to the amount of ground he covered, the grass that he covered in terms of screening the two centre-backs, yeah, Terry and Cavallo, I think it would have been.
Yeah.
And then latter-day Kante.
Yeah.
I honestly and truly, I think it's about placement of players. And then the other key element, massive key element, is distances between players, both attacking and defending. And that's why I think, Marv, when I look at the way I would set up and its fluidity and the way it can evolve into 3-5-2 or 5-3-2 or 4-3-3 or 3-4-3, that's why I would set up. If you write it down on a piece of paper and the placement of players, and then when you coach it, concentrate on the distances. So support when you've got the ball, movement when you've got the ball, and then basically making play predictable and restricting movement when you haven't got the ball would be 5-diamond-1. But he played this thing, unless I didn't know what I was looking at, he played this thing Romania 4-3-3. Now, the reason, there's a few things you've got to question here. One is, have they rehearsed it? Because it didn't look like it to me. If they have... It looks like they've rehearsed it wrongly, and quite possibly it hasn't been well coached enough or coached well enough, and they're leaving it to the football IQ of the players. They're giving them liberty of thought, because the reasons for playing 4-3-3, there's quite a few, actually. One could be you're just trying to mirror the opposition, right? Because they're giving you a problem. So what you're doing in terms of like a marking problem, so what you do, you just mirror the opposition to basically cancel it out. But then you're fundamentally looking for a 1-0, because what's imperative is, if you look at this, one of the other reasons for playing 4-3-3 would be to keep your front players one in the middle, two high and wide, to keep the opposition pushed back and pushed higher, regardless of what formation they play. Let me give you a quick for instance. If they play five at the back, you're giving them a problem. You're giving them a decision to make whereby do the wing backs stay in situ to cancel out your high and wide players, which I thought we were diabolical, and we were out-coached and out-tacticked. And I had this disagreement with Hudson about, it weren't down to Modric. Then I said, no, it wasn't. It was down to piss-poor organisation, failure to recognise and correct the coaching, right? So the reason for playing players high and wide in a three would be to try and keep the wing-backs pushed back, right? Or give them a decision to make whereby the opposition say, no, what we're going to do, we're going to release our wing backs. And what we'll do, we'll let whatever side the ball's on, we'll let that the central defenders, the three on that side, he comes over and they shuffle over and he marks on the outside, right? Or he marks inside to out, right? So he actually, in effect, a centre-back is becoming like a, if it's our right, their left, it becomes a left-sided centre-back stroke, left-back.
Yeah.
Right? And then the middle one will shuffle over and then the other one will shuffle over and mark inside to out. Where in an ideal situation, when the ball's in the channel, you want your centre-backs marking on the outside, right? So that would be another reason. Taking you on to the next step, right?
I just want to make that, just hold that thought. You said about inside marking on the inside and marking on the outside. So if, just quickly, if I understand that rightly, what you're saying is when an opposition attacks, if the centre half is being pulled out further wide, he should be marking, if the player's in front of him, to the right-hand side of that player. Is that what you're saying? Or to the left? Down the line, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, well, say it's coming down our left, right? Yeah. So I'm the left side central defender.
Yeah.
And we've said, no, what we're not going to worry about their two high forwards who are playing wide, like England did. So like Rashford and was it Sancho, the other one? I'm gonna release my wing back and say, no, go on, you crack on and we'll stick to our own pattern of play. Then what I would do, if he comes in field, right? Yeah. So like Sancho did a lot, then if the ball is with England's right back, I would give myself, if it's in that outside, what I said about coaching in three thirds long ways, if it's in the outside tranche, then I would be a yard and a half off his shoulder and I'd be marking on the outside. So if the ball's going to be played into the channel, I would spin in and win that race and deal with it.
You'll be closer
if he's really wide, then I would then become left centre back stroke, left full back, and I would mark inside to
inside,
out.
Fine. So it depends on the attacking position. The tackle's position.
So you take your shape off of where he is.
And it
ain't hard, even though it's happening like that, it's not hard. So the wider he is, the more in relation inside to where you are, you mark inside to out. You say, go on, then punch the ball out to him, and then you go and shut him down. That's where I think we should be coached to shut the lines off and defend and force the ball inside, because then it's about the recovery runs of your teammates and the placement of the players. Like I said, placement of players and distances.
So
you become very difficult to break down. Right now, going on to the next stage. If you're going to play 4-3-3, then if you look at the situation with regards to Romania, what they've done, they kept insurance in place. So they had a minimum of one, sometimes two spare players. Well, then what you've got to do is you've got to get, if you're one of the high and wide players like Sancho or Rashford, you've then got to engage that fullback on that side, and you've got to think about trying to make an angled run inside to maybe play off of Harry Kane or Dominic Calvert-Lewin, and or a dummy run to clear the space for the fullback, right? To come up and join the play.
Yeah.
Or you can even do like I used to coach. Again, it's distances. You could get a rotation going with the nearest midfield player, which again, I said five diamond one. So he's already in that vicinity. He's already in that area whereby my personal preference on the right would be Mount, on the left would be Grealish. Placement of players and distances. They can play off the front man. They can come and get it short, or they can do a rotation and they can engage that space high and wide, which would be the right and left wing positions, which I think he does ever so well, Grealish in particular. Right. And then what happens is you get your fullback just to come under it and he rotates. So if it pops out or if it breaks down, you're compact and you already got players in positions to deal with any knockdowns or any second balls. That's just my personal preference anyway. If I was coaching it, which you do in stages, it'd be much easier to explain or explain it on a flip chart so you can see fundamentally like the basic movements.
So it sounds that's really interesting, because Lee Dixon made a comment in commentary that he thought Rashford was playing really well and his runs were fantastic. And obviously when you're watching the game, you can't see his runs. So he could obviously see a sort of vista of the pitch that I couldn't, or we couldn't. But given your explanation then of the importance of those high and wide players to make runs to create space and opportunity for other players, I actually thought his end product was pretty poor, Rashford. I think he's had a poor season. And yet the pundits, when asked about those question marks, who plays in them high and wide positions, they all said Rashford. So is there something I'm missing that actually being very good at running and creating runs that benefit other players is as good as, if not better than, what you do when you've got the ball at your feet? Obviously, ideally, you want both. But is that why he's in the team? Because he's so, is that why the pros, because I'm not a pro, or an ex-pro, are saying he's got to be in the team because of that running capacity? Did that make sense?
Yeah, quite possibly, yeah. Pace and power. Yeah, quite possibly. And he showed great composure for the penalty, wasn't it?
Yeah, I guess so.
Or for the thing that when he notched.
It's a penalty. Then, yeah, he's entitled to knock a penalty.
And then he missed it, the other one, didn't he? He ain't played enough football for me.
No, Henderson, no.
That's the other debate today, Henderson. And I've just seen him on Sky doing a thing, but I wasn't watching it because I was helping my wife do the housework. But the having me a little workout in the garage. Talking about Henderson, I don't think he's played enough football. He's got the experience, he's got the leadership skills, he's very vocal, he's very upfront, puts himself forward for a lot of stuff on and off the field. I just don't think he's... I'm watching a programme very quickly, Joe. I was watching a programme the other night about something along the lines of the title was what it's like, or who'd be the England manager, or what it's like to be the England manager. And they went through the ages. And when you look at it, it confirmed what I already know. It's just like a disorganised clusterfuck, with the exception of two. Which was Venables and Oddle. The rest of it was shambolic, and we just muddle our way through. And that comes from the top. I'll go on the record now, and I'll state my case now. I think England are going to find it difficult to get out of the group. They might shock me. They might shock the world. They might obliterate Croatia. They might obliterate Scotland and Czechoslovakia as well. But I'll think to myself... there could be, there could be a case for confused thinking that have muddied the waters. And as a consequence, we could struggle to get out of the group. Secondly, I'll say 100% it's not Southgate's fault. He's basically doing the best he can with the hand he's been dealt. And I think he could have made better appointments to the backroom staff. What happened to Croatia wouldn't have happened if it sounds fucking ridiculous. It sounds arrogant, narcissistic, and fucking delusional. But it wouldn't have happened if I'd have been on the touchline. When I see him leaving Harry up there on his own against Croatia, and then they left. They had three centre backs, and then they left two to deal with him, and then the others came and joined in, and then pushed the fullbacks on to engage our wing backs, and then you had Henderson doing doggies in the middle of the park. It was just screaming out for a minor adjustment, two minor adjustments. One of them being someone up front to keep them pushed back and engage them and help Harry. And the other one was to bolster the numbers in the middle of the park. It wouldn't have happened. And it might well have been a different result, right? So that's the first thing. But the other thing is, what you've got to bear in mind is what a lot of people don't go or look into it as deep. And this is where I was good, right? And this is where, I'll give myself a pat on the back. And this is where I was top draw. And if the world and his wife and the majority of them are shit and they sell themselves, right? I should have been doing it for decades, but I haven't. I've just hovered in the background unless someone's lit the touch paper about something and I've gone from 0 to 100. It's about the education that the players have had. So all the coaches that those players, whose hands those players have passed through, and the FA coaching syllabus, they're the ones that are responsible for the fact that we've had no success. Mm. That's I don't lay it solely at the feet of whoever the England manager is. And then you'll get situations where, like under Venables, he wasn't afraid of knowledge. He surrounded himself with knowledge and experience.
Don Howe and all that, yeah.
Don Howe and Brian Robson. Mm. Do you know what I mean? And he's like, well, go on, you go and talk to the players. You've only just finished playing. Don, what do you think? Da, da, da. And then he's got his own ideas, like radical, innovative passing and movement and defensive ideas that he honed at Barcelona.
So I watched that programme as well, and I thought it was quite interesting from Kevin Keegan when he was talking on there. Very honest, to be fair to him. And I guess he would never have say he was a tactical genius when it came to how he managed sides. It was all, you know, quite a simple approach. Just get very good attacking players and just go for it. If you lose, if as long as you score more than the other team, it's fine. But it was interesting how he was saying he just couldn't handle the downtime. And basically, it was a case of when they turn up, you basically just sort of throw them out there and don't really have much input. And even Roy Hodgson touched on that. So it's funny, isn't it, how you've got a different... You basically got to trust, like you say, that in a sort of embedded coaching that those players have had from a kid. Because you haven't got enough time to change them.
That's so right.
It's only like probably 10% of dust you've got to sprinkle on the top.
Well, it was like when I was in the game and certain people came through the ranks, and there's one that springs to mind who made his debut as a 17-year-old. The bottom line is, when you're employed by a football club, when you're employed by the FA, right, your job is to, like I've always said, the more complete the coach, the more complete the footballer. Your job is to turn out decent footballers with decent football IQs. And I can't believe some of the nonsense that was spoken on that documentary, right? The first thing is, slight contradiction in what you said about scoring more than the opposition. I think it's ironic that he resigned after a 1-0 defeat out under Germany. I was going to say to you, well, what happens when you come up against Germany or Italy? You're not going to be fucking beating them 5-4. They're going to be beating you 1-0. Yeah, and then, or nick a goal and then play Catenaccio. You know what I mean? Like in the case of the eye ties, right? And then you've got Adams, who's very good football IQ, good football intelligence, good understanding of the game, comes out with complete bollocks and says to someone high up in the FA echelons, talk to him. You've got to talk to Kevin. He's gone into one, and I'm paraphrasing, obviously, but calm him down. He's talking about resigning. Well, Adam should know better, more than anybody, having played under the likes of Graham, George Graham, that he needed organisation because there's certain players can get away with it because for 6 years during their career or 8 years during their career, their pace and athleticism will get them out of trouble. Right. But Adams, more than anyone, should know that he needed to be in an organised unit to paper over certain cracks, similar to myself. There's no shame in it. Right. So, and then you've got Hodgson, got beat by the international equivalent of Wimbledon.
Yeah.
Iceland, right? 4-3-3, retreating into 4-5-1. We couldn't fucking find a way around it. You know what I mean? The best part about that game was the Iceland fans with the war cry. I was fuming. I was going berserk at the thing. And I'm really and truly, I'm resigned now. I'm coming up. I've said it. I mean, I live as long as my dad until at least the age of 80 because I deserve to because I'm a decent person and I've been a good father and a semi-decent husband. You know what I mean? Although I've done my best to fuck it up. But I want to live as long as my dad. And I've said England won't win anything during my lifetime. I'm convinced of it because I know the inside goings on. Mm. It needs anyone who's been radical or innovative, especially if they're English, scum press have got their teeth into them, like Oddle and Venables. Venables over his business practices. Oddle over being trapped, sucked in and trapped over comments he made on supposed theories about religion and afterlife and reincarnation. And yet, two foreigners come in the case of Ericsson. He says, my private life's my private life. And it basically went around, and you know the story. I don't know if you know the story. How he copped for the Nancy Dulally. She was
Nancy,
with
Nancy of Oil was Ulrika Johnson used to call her. That's what's quite funny.
Yeah, she was with a Lazio director, and he said about Sven being a gentleman, and he came to me and he said, look, you know, me and Nancy have been seeing each other. We want to make a go of it. I mean, I bet the geezer couldn't wait to get rid of her. He said he came and spoke like a gentleman. He said, on you go. And then he comes over here, gets the job, and then he's ended up, he fucked anything with a pulse. Do you know what I mean? He had mistresses for the mistress, and then mistress for the other, for the other mistress. Even though the hotel is famous, the hotel where he used to go, in the Leonard. Yeah.
And he done well, didn't he, considering, weren't he? He wasn't exactly the best. He weren't George Clooney, was he?
Nah, not many of us are.
No.
But at the end of the day, so, you know, it's I can confirm that a semblance of power can be an aphrodisiac. And then you've got the situation.
That's the fact that you can confirm that's an episode for another time.
Go on. we won't go there at the moment. It might be a revelation for my second book. It all depends on the governor, whether she'll allow it to go in. But the bottom line is, I was saved from the basically from the abyss by my good lady of 45 years. But anyway, the you go on to the next one. You talk about the goings on with Hodgson, even the World Cup. You know, you've got an under 14 mistake whereby you've got a flat delivery. We've already struggled, and then we're hanging on by a thread, and you get a flat delivery from the goalkeeper. I think it was dribbled it out or pinged it out on the half volley. And then that, I wouldn't have allowed it. You want Gerrard screening the front, but you don't want him right on your toes as a centre back. So you basically, in footballers' terms, you fuck him off and just say, just
you let the defender deal with it. Yeah.
Yeah. Cause you're like a goalkeeper.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're like, you want the area clear for you to come and attack the ball.
Yeah.
And it's like I said before, it's an under 14 mistake. So it's assess the flight, make a decision, communicate, deal with it. You understand? So assess the flight, communicate to Gerrard, my
get
ball,
out of the way. Yeah.
Ball, whoever, Terry's ball,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
Attack it and then punch the header, instead of which he comes and backs right onto his toes. Goal hanging, and he Suarez, he can't be asked to get on side. It fucking skims off his head and he's through. It smashes one into the roof of the net. See you later. We're flying home. Then he says, then the next championship, he says, I don't really know why I'm here. Well, I'll tell you why you're here, because you got beat by the international equivalent of fucking Wimbledon. That's why you're here.
It's funny, isn't it? Because I think we can all agree, certainly, you know, a lot bit more about it than me, but he's a very, very, very good coach, Roy Hodgson. And he's done remarkable things at Crystal Palace after what is arguably one of the worst managerial performances England's ever had. I mean, yes, he got England to the tournaments and other managers haven't done that. But once we were there, I'm not sure there's been a... It's about as bad as it gets in terms of tournament performances under Roy Hodgson. And yet he's arguably one of the best coaches we've had in the last 30 years.
I can agree or disagree. Yeah, no, I'll be honest with you. Like now, I tend to disagree for the simple reason I feel let down, because in a previous interview way, way, way back when, I endorsed Roy Hodgson because I said he hadn't been given enough credit as a sort of easygoing, humble gentleman. And I just said, like, we make, I used a stronger word, but I said in this country, we make heroes out of mugs and mugs out of heroes. I just said he hasn't been given enough credit. And I said, I'd like to see him when it was like a toss of a coin between him and Redknapp. I said, we need a head coach. We don't really, not a manager. And this is where I differ. I'm loggerheads in bygone days with Lord Hudson. I think any organisation can do, in terms of football organisation, that is, whether it's England, whether it's a club, you can do without a manager, but you can't do without a head coach. And he said, and then Lord Hudson says, well, it's the manager that brings it all together. So I said, so what's the point of a director of football? Et cetera, on it goes, you know what I mean? But when it came to endorsing him, I endorsed him, and then I felt very, very, very let down, Joe. And let me qualify it. Tying in with what you're saying about being one of the best coaches. He should be one of the best coaches at what he does, but for the simple reason, he hasn't coached any differently for 40 years. So that tells me he's got a distinct lack of imagination. And then what he can do, he can possibly blame it on the jobs that he's got, other than, I would suspect, other than Inter Milan, any international job he's got, England, Switzerland, Norwegian clubs like Crystal Palace, there's no star quality. When he went to a club where there was star quality, he couldn't handle it. That was Liverpool.
It's Liverpool, yeah.
You know what I mean? So that tells me he's got a distinct, he lacks one of the massive ingredients you need as a top manager or a top coach, which is imagination. I've always said one of a coach's biggest assets is his imagination to come up with new things. We don't know what we're going to do. We'll concede the ball. We'll retreat to a block 8 here. The two front players are split high and wide between the fullback and the centre back. And then we'll defend a certain way. And then again, it's like I said, placement of players and distances. And he's very good at that. Creating that block 8 and being very difficult to break down. It's all about. But then when people have got the ball wide against Crystal Palace, and you look at Cahill and whoever the other geezer is, and then the furthest centre back, normally the left back, Kouyaté, when the ball's on the other side, they struggle to defend in the box. That was the way to beat Palace. Hmm. Do you know what I mean? But yeah, when you look at it down the ages, I just think like there's a common denominator, there's a common thread. And I think it underpins my theory and it maintains my theory, which is if there's any problems or blame to be apportioned, it's in the syllabus and it's in the coaches who have had the players pass through their hands. Because what should happen is when you get to that level, it should be the easiest thing in the world to say, right, it's like I've always said, like I was at Chelsea, a very well-educated footballer, I could slip into any position in a back four, which I did, and I can slip into any position in a back three, which I did, or any position in a back five, which I did. And then the team could play any system because Chelsea turned out well-educated footballers.
Sort of malleable
footballers. With a decent IQ from back in the 70s.
You know I mean, I wonder, we like an analogy on this show, but I wonder if, you know, if you look at what you're saying about ultimately these are the elite of the elite, theoretically on paper, yep, they are the best 23 players in England. I mean, there's a really interesting stat actually on Gareth Southgate wrote that letter, Dear England, which I thought was quite well written. But there's only 1,200 players have ever played for England since its inception. So it is extremely elite. And I guess if you look at a sort of a special forces team, they've gone through that ground, didn't they? They've gone through their initial training at 15, 16 when they joined the army, all the way through the different regiments and wherever they, in the normal armed forces. And then they get into the elite. Now, not that I've been involved in that, but you would assume, yes, they're well drilled, but ultimately they're so well drilled over historically that they know what to do in situations. So when something happens, it's all on autopilot and they do it and they execute it.
Yeah.
And so do we overplay the coach role for England? I know that's kind of going against what you said about coach is more important than the manager, but given, or do we need a coach more precisely because those players haven't had as good a grounding as other countries? You know, Brazil get Scolari, and who apparently did the most boring training sessions known to man when he was at Chelsea and didn't do fuck all, but won the World Cup with Brazil because he just put a little bit of gold dust and told them a couple of things and maybe got them patriotic or whatever before a game. Yeah. And they went out there and done their bit. So is it sort of horses for courses? You know, we can't rely on that historical grounding because our coaching is not good enough. So therefore you need a
I know we can't. You just contradicted yourself slightly. Do you know what I mean? Because
what I'm saying is it's, I suppose that's the optimal is that you're dealing with elites that can coach themselves. They know what they need to do, and you just need to, you know, sprinkle that gold, that dust. But for England, they obviously don't seem to appear to be at that level.
Yeah, well, I always said, Joe, I've always maintained you don't just play football, you feel it. Right. So what you're saying about doing stuff instinctively, that comes from something that's deep embedded within you from as a kid. And it's like I said, when I was highly motivated as a young coach, and had a thirst for knowledge and a hunger for success in whatever guise at Leighton Orient, I got rid of all the Sunday morning managers and I only wanted fully qualified coaches that had had quality assurance checks by myself, which again is a bit narcissistic and arrogant. But at the end of the day,
Well, it's your goal, isn't it?
Well,
It's your blueprint.
Not only that, it's implicit trust in your own judgment. And I thought I was putting together a decent team. The point
Nothing
being,
wrong with that, John.
The point being, when players go through the age groups, they've been so well taught, they start to do stuff and they slot in instinctively. Oh, you nudge them and give them a little reminder every now and then. I remember talking to a player when he had a couple of million pound moves after I'd had him from the age of 13. And he just said, after what you taught me, Sitz, I'll be honest with you. He said, it came easy. The decision making and recognizing a certain situation, it just came to me easy.
Yeah.
And when I saw him play at Ibury and mark Thierry Henry out of the game and get an away win for Birmingham or West Brom. Anyway, who'd have thought that? Mm. You know what I mean? The team that would go on to become the Invincibles. It made me very proud.
Yeah.
And then another one was, I think, a cup win at White Hart Lane. Yeah, it made me very proud. But the bottom line being, anyway, forget all that indulgence. I think it's down to the, first of all, the syllabus, because it's like we said before, you said about analogies, right? It's like I said to you before, right? There's a uniform way. You do your separate test for your highway code. There's a uniform way that you are taught to drive. Well, it's exactly the same. And picking you up on your thing about Dear England, right? Dear England is going to mean absolutely fuck all if we don't get out of the group, right? And then it's the whatever, the last 16, then the last 8, then the last 4, then, and dare I say, get to the final, right? We counted out the other day that first of all, the bookies are no mugs. With regards to the betting that I've been checking out, so I said, what are the odds for not getting out of the group? They're far shorter than they are for us. They're far shorter for us than they are for us actually winning it. Right? So the bookies are no mugs, right? And then we actually counted the other week when we did a review of or the build up to the Euros with a bit of the last podcast show. We counted out at least 7 teams that were going to be tough.
They're in the running, yeah.
And they're in the running and quite possibly better than us, right? Mm. But the bottom line is, going back to the original thing, right, you learn to drive in a uniform way, then everyone goes away and drives differently. It's what I've said to you. You've got people like me who are fantastic drivers. I'm a professional driver. I've been a black cab driver for 18 and a half years, right? I don't take liberties. I don't pull out on people. I don't cut people up. I think you've got to be, you've got to have foresight, you've got to have patience, you've got to have calmness, you've got to be a gentleman of the road whereby you let people into the flow of the traffic like I do, which is very rarely reciprocated because the world and his wife think their time's more important than everybody else's, so they drive like fucking lunatics, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So you've got drivers like me, you've got drivers who somewhere between Lewis Hamilton wannabe or auditioning for driving Miss Daisy Part 2. Right, so two extremes, and then the third category of driver is someone who should never have been allowed near a set of ignition keys. Well, it's the same three categories of coach. You've got people who are fantastic coaches, do a good conscientious job with every player that comes under them. You've got people who are all right. Some of us make the mistake of wanting to get too far too quickly, so that's the Lewis Hamilton thing. Others are auditioning for driving Miss Daisy Part 2, so you might get a decent coaching point out of them once every fucking 8 sessions, and then you've got others who should never have been allowed near a set of ignition keys or should never have got their coaching badge. You understand what I mean?
Yeah.
It's all a numbers game. It's like the country. You understand? Mm-hmm. I'm doing the book, right? And I keep rewriting it. Then I'm going to release it. Then I'm checking it. Then the lawyers get involved. Then I can't say this. Then I can say that. Then I tie it in with, before we come on air, we were talking about political history and war history, which our listeners don't know about. I was trying to tie the book in, and it's never more prevalent or evident than, and I think it's wrong, whereby sport is inextricably linked, particularly football, to politics. And I think it's wrong, right? Well, you've got this situation now where we're looking at a situation where we're talking about everything other than what we should be talking about, which is the core elements of the game, which is the quality of the coaching syllabus and the coaching. Nothing else matters. Nothing else matters, right? Mm-hmm. And it's like I say about the thing, Paul Elliott sitting there, he's probably getting a blinding living out of it. And you've got this big poster, X amount, we guarantee X amount of BAME coaches by the year 2000 and something. We guarantee X amount of women coaches. But Well, how can you guarantee that? They might not be good enough. 1,100 BAME coaches might not be good enough. So what do? Do you give them a badge because they're BAME? But then again, there might be BAME coaches out there, 2,500, 3,000, 5,000, who are all fantastic coaches, better than anything we've got. So, you know what I mean? You might exceed that amount. I just think like it's become a silly political game.
It's such a hard existential fundamental change. And that's why politicians, the FA, I suppose they just can't be bothered to make such wholesale overarching changes. So they finesse around the edges.
And when they do well, the Prime Minister jumps on the bandwagon. Didn't they? Blair jumped on the bandwagon. Mm. Cameron jumped on the bandwagon. Then when we get knocked out, they go on the missing list. They don't say, they send congratulations, they send a G up. And then they go, when we get knocked out, another penalty shootout or another fucking crushing disappointment like Iceland, they go on the missing list, don't say anything. Then you've got like the arrogance of managers who think they're entitled not to be there and give an explanation. Well, what he's doing, he's Hodgson at the time, he's just protecting his own career. Because if it was me, I'll say, well, you know that thing the last time when the geezer said, which was the failed, he was part of the failed digital IT or digital TV thing with football.
ITV digital, yeah.
So he somehow manages to get a top job at the FA. And then he says, in front of, we're going to have a roots and branch review. No, well, that was fucking 30 years ago. 25, 24, 28, 26, 22, 20 years ago. How many more root and branch reviews we're going to say? If I'd have been Austin, I'd have gone, well, I'd have qualified. My reasons for thinking that I shouldn't be there.
So just going back to the point about our players not having elite level coaching history within their makeup. Are you saying that they're not good enough in a comparative sense to those other seven countries we were talking about?
Well, there's always something wrong.
Yeah.
Joe, there's always something wrong. Mm. There's always something wrong. Capello, I'm only going to take players that are in form and not injured. He takes Ledley King. You know what I mean? This type of nonsense. Yeah. You could argue that the Manchester City players, Foden and Sterling, they've been under the best coach or one of the top three coaches on the planet.
Yeah.
Right? Well, Sterling, he ain't had a very good year. No. And he's come out the billboards in the Evening Standard, London Evening Standard, which you wouldn't have seen yesterday. Well, I'm not really bothered if I don't start. You know what I mean? What kind of attitude is that?
Well,
I'm not getting stressed if I don't start. Right.
Very
but then the flip side of the coin, that's the guy I'd put in. I don't care how young he is. And I said he's got to get his act together when he started remonstrating and acting the goat when he got sent home. Foden, I'd have at the tip of the diamond playing off of Harry Kane. Because of how he explodes shots off with a very short back lift, and he sees little balls in here and little balls in there, and he drops his shoulder and goes by people. He can buy free kicks. I'd have him in front of Sterling all day long because there's an end product to him. Sterling, he'll beat someone. He'll come back and try and beat him again.
And Grealish instead of Rashford?
I'd have Grealish on the left of the diamond. Well, the beauty of it is you've got players second fiddle in brackets all over the place. Do you know what I mean? You've got Foden brackets Sterling. You've got Kane brackets Calvert-Lewin as the lone front man. Then at the tip of the domino, I'd have Foden brackets Sterling. The right, I'd have Mount brackets Sancho. On the left, Grealish brackets Rashford. Yeah, but at the base of the diamond screen in the two, the three centre-backs, Rice brackets Henderson, although I don't think he's played enough football.
Yeah.
And so on and so on.
Well, for the purposes of the first, your first team, it would be Foden and Grealish and Rice and Mount, Kane.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
That'd be my front five. Yeah.
Yeah. Just quickly, a very, very quick question I want to ask you before we go. The backup, the bracket players, Jude Bellingham and Bukayo Saka. What's the point in them being in the squad? Are they going to play? Are they going to add value? Do they deserve to be there?
Well, if you've got anything, I just think as a player, if you've got anything about you, everything's added value. They can learn from training in the big boy squad. They can learn from being around it. They can learn from watching the opposition if they sit there on the bench instead of acting the goat. and putting towels over their head or headphones or whatever the fuck they do to it. When I see them, they're always like, whether it's Premier League level, you know, different people do different things. I wasn't sub very often, but I knew I would watch the game and I knew if I got on any position in the back four, I would be looking at the wide players and the front players of the opposition, how I'm going to deal with them, etc. So the point being, I think they can get out, and then the other thing is the wild card. They can get something out of it. Then the other thing is the wild card aspect. You could go on and you could have a 17-year-old like Bellingham, 18, whatever he is, go on and make a name for himself.
Think he's good enough to do that?
Throw him in. Well, yeah, I mean, I'd pull him to one side. Like I said to you before, I wouldn't be happy with that, like waving his arms about and remonstrating with much more senior players because they haven't given him the ball. Yeah, by all means, you could say without the camera seeing, you could give him a rocket, you could give him a bollocking. You could say, if I scream for the fucking ball, give me the ball, I want the ball. Do you know what I mean? That's brilliant. That's a brilliant thing to have, an attribute to have. But all this carry on. Do you know what I mean? Nah.
Yeah.
And I'll just say it's bad. It's bad for you. It's bad for your teammates, and it's brilliant for the opposition. Body language is very important.
Just lastly then, so going back to your point about the odds and that we're shorter priced to not get out of the group than we are to win it. What's your predictions? I know you kind of said we might not get out of the group, but is that still your prediction?
I can sense a win and two draws.
Okay.
But then I think that's going to put us on par with one of the other countries, and then one of the other countries will get a draw and two wins. So I think we might be second or equal second in the group. Then I don't know what the thing is because I ain't gone into it deep enough. It ain't
no, but that leads us that's a hard second game.
Harder path. Harder path.
Okay.
Yeah, you want to win the group. I mean, personally, no disrespect. Because I think they could cause an upset. I just think the coaching, the organisation, the togetherness, the spirit, and the fundamentals are in place for Scotland to cause an upset.
Yeah.
And then you've got Croatia, which is the first one, and then you've got the Czechs who just come. I think we should beat Czechoslovakia. My two doubts are the sweaties and Croatia.
But you know what'll happen with Czech Republic? They'll have 10 men behind the ball and won't fucking struggle to break them down. It'll be a turgid affair, 65, 70 minutes in. Players get twitchy. All of a sudden, they're not showing for the ball, they're hiding.
Yeah.
Fucking same old story. But anyway, let's try and be positive.
Yeah, you've got to be positive. You've got to try and be positive. But that goes back to, again, the coaching. You've got to embed it in players. Something, again, I've always said, we're not streetwise enough. We don't pull enough strokes. We're too honest. We're too English. We're too British. We're too English. We don't pull enough strokes. You've got to be a dub as a manager and a coach. You know, wait and see tomorrow. I mean, I might be so far wide of the mark, it's unbelievable, right? But wait and see tomorrow when Italy, Turkey, right? Wait and see how many tactical fouls there are tomorrow.
Cool, yeah.
There'd be fucking geezers doing the Fosbury flop all over the gaff.
Do you know what I mean?
To gain an advantage.
Yeah.
Well, I don't care. I wouldn't care what the you got like. I mean, who are these people? I mean, I'm looking at him making these comments. Who the fuck are these people? Like Emery Winter. Well, I wasn't thinking we'd have gone after him. Who are you?
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Well, what did you do? Play fucking croquet or something at a public school?
Yeah,
and you've got the right to comment on what someone's spent a lifetime trying to create or get into.
It can not formulate a sentence, but you can sack people from the England job. Shocking, isn't it?
Well, this is the power they've got. Do you know what I mean? But what it is, and I think he's been really good at it, what he does, he calls it the connect. The way they've reconnected with the fans and they've tried to do it with the media. I think it's either that or 100% siege mentality, whereby you've got to give them access, I suppose, contractually. You know what I mean? That's another thing. The contracts are all, everything's laughable, isn't it? One of the biggest sponsors is they're talking. You've got the Prime Minister, you've got the world and his wife talking about an obese nation. You're talking about the strain on the NHS. You're talking about NHS funding. You're talking about getting kids in sport. You're talking about kids doing this, kids doing that, being more active. Who's the sponsors? McDonald's.
Oh,
I know. It's that's how it was when I was there, when I was coaching for the FA via the LFA. Everything was revolving around McDonald's. I just used to laugh because I couldn't believe the irony. You know what I mean? I couldn't believe the irony. But there it is. But what you've got is you've got the situation where they've got the power to make or break the media in this country. Yes, you've got to try and be positive, but I just think I'm marking everybody's card, trying to mark everybody's card, whereby I think it's a case of historically, they talk about golden generations of players. They talk about, me personally, I talk about great coaches who've gone through the system. Yeah. Yeah, they were confrontational and fractious. People like John Cartwright, Malcolm Allison. But they were a loss to the game.
Well, their knowledge, their Ferguson innovation. Was, wasn't he? Best manager
ever.
Yeah,
but he said, I don't care. I mean, he's another one. He's got a way, just fantastic management. Very clever. Yeah. But at the biggest football club on the planet, if you can't procure the best players, then there's got to be a stewards, which he managed to do. Then he put people in place. But all that, I wouldn't betray my country when they said about him in managing England. But he accepted a knighthood. I'm not betraying Scotland, but I'll accept a knighthood.
Yeah.
Yeah. You get me, what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do. But, you know, what I'm saying is he put people's noses out of joint. You know, he weren't a yes man. That's for sure.
Oh, well, that's right. The decision makers, I'm talking about people who were innovative, Joe. I'm talking about people who had foresight.
Yeah.
And innovation. And because their personalities were too blue, you look at the thing, that damn United, which was on the other night. I watched that for the third time. Well, this is what used to happen. And I remember it happening to me. You go and sit up, a massive long table. They've been next door having a lunch or plate some like sandwiches or whatever, you know, a massive like running buffet. You go there, the sweat's pissing out you because you've accumulated too many bookings, and you're sitting in front of all these fucking fat slobs with blazers on who've never kicked a ball in their life. He's from the regional Berkshire regional FA. He's from he represents the FA at 16 Lancaster Gate. He's from the Hertfordshire FA. He's from the Essex FA. He's from some other fucking FA. Then they give you a free match ban. Do you know what I mean? And you, when I look at that, I just think to yourself, yep, if that was to sum it up, the scene where they banned Billy Bremner for 12 matches, whatever it is, well, that's exactly what it was like. But my brother-in-law's been up there to the Wembley. And he just said, you go in there for a hearing. This was about alleged racism. Because my brother-in-law's obviously Greek Cypriot, and then he's got a load of ethnics playing for him at Haringey Borough because it's a very diverse borough. So then there was this big thing. And he said, it's unbelievable when you go up there. He said, it's like a 5-star hotel. You've got like this massive, like running buffet, all the drink you can think of, bottles of mineral water, massive vats of coffee and tea and da, 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 da. I mean, you know, this is for people to sit there who don't know the circumstances, don't know the backstory, don't know what's going on, never kicked a pair of boots, kicked a ball in anger, never laced a pair of boots on in anger, and they're passing judgment on you. Yeah, this is what it was like. But it's the same with the syllabus. But now I'm led to believe. I mean, I ain't been anywhere near it. The last time I went anywhere was Lillishall, 1997, to convert over to the UEFA. Same stuff regurgitated. And then they go, do you want to do the diploma? Well, I read through the syllabus. Same stuff regurgitated. Role-playing. And then now it's evolved from role-playing, because I had the row with Jimmy Arnfield, like I've mentioned before on here. I said, well, what's this? We're like, what fucking set of EastEnders? We're talking about, you've got someone, my mate Neil Banfield, playing the part of a manager, talking to a player who's got an STD, got his girlfriend pregnant, and his wife don't know about either. And he said, like, I've started, and oh, just nonsense. Now it's about well-being and which I could have done with in my era.
Yeah.
See why so many players go off the rails when they pack up playing and there's nothing left for them, and they become gambling and alcoholics and gambling addicts. So, you know, it takes a special mentally tough type of person to manage to get through it.
Yeah.
Or someone with that and a decent family life.
Because there's no aftercare,
but,
yeah.
There's no aftercare. But that is well-being and I think social awareness. You know what I mean? So why not bring in guest coaches and I remember a thing someone said to me about, he was asking me about my coaching theory on defending. And then he said, well, I've done a thing and he'd done a course. And this, he happened to be there when I was there. Particular coach said, I want you to show him inside. He didn't say anything about how to approach the ball, how to exaggerate his body position, his starting position. If he come up against a tricky winger, to exaggerate the starting position by bending his run, the placement of the second, third, fourth player furthest from the ball, the second defender, the third and fourth defender furthest from the ball. So you've got your recovering midfield players and your defenders, maybe even a forward trying to get backwards of the ball to... Anyway, now I just want you to show him inside. Well, he's going to come in and unload a shot. Well, I'm not bothered about that. Just show him inside. You've got to explain and qualify everything.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And find solutions. And I just think we've found one.
We're miles behind. Yeah. On that positive note, John, let's call it a day, and we'll reconvene post-mortem. England Croatia beginning next week.
Well, I'll be highly delighted if we carry on with a clean sheet and nick a 1-0 like we did against Austria and ride our luck. That'll do me.
Yeah, okay. Well, let's hope it isn't a post-mortem. Let's hope it isn't after death. But we shall see. all right, guys. As always, good. I think you mentioned, John, that the subscribers are up, which is great news. So I'm glad people are liking us being back on air and
And looking up to John's channel.
exactly. This is what you come for, positivity in all aspects. But yeah, no, keep liking, subscribing, retweeting John's posting and stuff, and DM me or DM John if you've got any questions for me to ask, and see you next week, guys.
Yeah, will do. Thanks, guys. Thank you.